Good afternoon once again. Dave Watts with you this hour, and a fascinating hour it is ahead of us as we look back at the Tech Talks seminar held this past Wednesday, and literally we're going to take it from there. This hour, our guests include the Executive Vice President and General Manager at CareWorx, Marco LaVecchia. Good afternoon, Marco. Great to see you again.
Nice to see you. Thanks for having me back.
You're very welcome. Also in the studio, a very special welcome to Piero Chiodo. He's the Vice President at IBM Global Technology Services. Good afternoon, Piero.
Hello. Delighted to be here. Thank you for hosting me.
You're very welcome, and it's great to meet you, and I'm looking forward to chatting with you this hour. Piero was the keynote speaker at Wednesday's Tech Talks at the Central Beer House in Canada. But this hour, though, in addition to bringing you up to date with CareWorx Managed Services, we're going to discuss one of the hottest topics on everyone's mind these days, AI, artificial intelligence. And Piero, I'd like to begin with a special welcome to you, and perhaps we can start off with a little on your background and professional responsibilities.
Yeah, absolutely. So as of now, I am a vice president at IBM responsible for development, deployment, sales support, and partnerships in the workplace support services business. Help desk, desk side support, everything IT related to help our clients improve their productivity and improve their user experience as they receive support. Within that development, we have traditional help desk services, and we added a number of new technologies like automated password reset, Watson artificial intelligence capabilities, remote takeover, and more. We have a global mission, but of course, Canada is one of our most exciting marketplaces where we have a lot of great clients who are deploying our technology. And we have this partnership with CareWorx, which is certainly very exciting for all of us.
Perfect. Well, we're going to get into more conversation along the way, Piero, as AI, artificial intelligence, is such a fascinating topic. But Marco, I just want to invite you to jump in here and give us some background on CareWorx itself. I know we've been together on these shows in the past, but perhaps for newer listeners, maybe an audience that aren't quite aware, what is CareWorx? How long has it been around? And what are some of the functions that you folks do?
Sure. So great to be here today, and thank you very much for having us. CareWorx is a large managed service provider located here in Ottawa. We look after small, medium-sized businesses for all their IT needs. So anything from software, hardware, managed services, security, business continuity. We're really a one-stop shop for anything from an IT perspective. So an organization that either doesn't have an IT department, or even organizations that do have an internal IT department but need assistance, need some specialization, may need some professional services from some senior engineers, we could come in and work with them and help them out for anything.
And I guess it doesn't really matter the size of the organization either. It could be a small business. It could be perhaps even as small as a mom and pop, all the way up to a multinational.
Yeah, absolutely. Like, we do have what you would call mom and pops, and they're great customers. And all the way up to, we have some organizations that have 25,000 employees that we handle their level one service desks for. So we're a chameleon of all sorts, and we really kind of specialize in a number of different areas.
How does CareWorx stay ahead of the curve in order to best serve clients? Because technology seems to be changing every minute.
Absolutely. It's technology is wonderful, and it's also scary at the same time. Yeah. When you take a look at some organizations that you know, they haven't adopted any of the new technologies, and maybe they made a technology purchase 4 or 5 years ago, it kind of makes us nervous as a business, because, you know, security comes into effect, data backup solutions sometimes become non-existent and can start impacting organizations. So we're always trying to take a look ahead of the curve, see what's coming down the pipe. And, you know, as an example, partnering up with an organization like IBM and taking a look at what are they using. They're obviously an organization and a company that's the forefront of technologies. If they're starting to adopt and go down the road, and it's a good idea to maybe partner up with them and see what they're doing.
So it's a learning curve for your staff too. I mean, they're always constantly being kept up to date.
Absolutely. We do internal training all the time. Our engineers and our technicians clinicians and our professional services teams, they're always at the forefront. So if we do decide that we need to adopt a technology, we make that decision at a product steering committee, and that product steering committee then implements the solution, the technology, and how it impacts the businesses that we work with.
You know, it's not a scary prospect for a small business in particular to be into IT in terms of what is needed to keep them competitive, because basically the CareWorx aim and goal is to keep technology uncomplicated. Wow, you can't beat that.
Absolutely. I mean, that's really kind of our mantra. And, you know, to add to that, it's really ensuring that the customer end user experience is phenomenal. And that impacts everything from the first time you make a call into our service desk to the tools that we leverage. We really want to make sure at the end of the day that no matter what kind of business that you have, it's running properly and you're supposed to do what we do. And then we'll look after the technology and the complicated things for you.
Maybe you could give us a brief word on CareWorx managed services.
Yeah, so our managed services program is all about doing proactivity for our customers, making sure that the environment is up and running all the time so that, you know, if you have employees and they need to do email or they have to surf the web or they just have to do software development, that it's working. And the whole point of managed services is a proactive nature opposed to a reactive business model where you have to call into a support desk to report a problem. So we leverage technology to allow us to proactively monitor and manage devices that are on a network that gives us alerts to let us know what's going on. And it's just a different way about how we go to market and work with our customers. It's a much, it's a better way to support the customers. Customer satisfaction rates are much higher because there's value in terms of the service that we bring to the table.
Absolutely. Of course, another big thing too are partners. You've got to have a real good network of partners in order to bring it all together.
Absolutely. We're not an organization that goes out and develops all of these solutions. We have to come to the table and we have to work with companies like IBM to leverage the technologies and solutions that they create, whether that's in the security, whether it's in business continuity, whether it's remote monitoring and management. So it's always about evaluating the right types of tools that are out there and then making sure that, for instance, that it's the right type of technology that maps to what the customer's needs are.
Perfect. Well, we have lots more to go here on 580 CFRA's Experts on Call. Our guest this hour is Marco LaVecchia. He's the Executive Vice President and General Manager at CareWorx, and Piero Chiodo. He's the Vice President, IBM Global Technology Services. Experts on Call is the program. We'll be right back on News Talk 580 CFRA. Experts on Call continues on News Talk 580 CFRA. A very interesting hour on the go here. Marco LaVecchia is our guest. He's the Executive Vice President and General Manager at CareWorx. And a special guest this hour is Piero Chiodo. He's the Vice President, IBM Global Technology Services. And Piero, it's great to meet you and welcome to Canada. I know you've been a busy guy flying around all over the place and bringing folks up to date on what's happening from a technology standpoint. And I think that AI is an amazing growth curve for the future. I think this is great. But IBM has been so integral in getting AI, artificial intelligence, rolling. Perhaps you can give us some background on that.
Sure. Well, thank you for giving me this opportunity to share some of the history of AI at IBM. And I would like to demystify for a moment the concept of AI and with a little bit of going back in time. And a lot of this started way back then during the shooting of 2001 Space Odyssey.
Okay.
And you may remember the computer name was HAL, H-A-L.
Yeah, I do.
And that was decided because it comes as a letters before IBM. So the concept was something even before IBM. And IBM was part of that, giving the voice, giving the font, and the interaction. Mm-hmm. And in a nutshell, that was the foundation of AI. It's a computer that thinks, reasons, works with you, but most importantly, is really helping the individual make better decisions, live a better life. So the entire design point is not to replace people, is to help them have a better work experience. In IBM, we like to call it augmented intelligence, okay, as opposed to artificial.
Okay.
Now, moving forward, a few years later, we had the chess tournament where IBM defeated Kasparov.
I remember that.
And that was, again, one example of the power of a thinking, reasoning machine, looking at a huge amount of options and picking and choosing the best course of action. Come to yesterday, and you saw Watson playing Jeopardy and winning. And that was kind of adding to the ability to go through data, huge amount of data stored in the machine, but also understanding the language. It's the syntax, putting words in a context. And that was the great breakthrough. That's really the foundation of the Watson that we have today.
I was just thinking, that would have to be because you only can get out, correct me if I'm wrong, but you can only get out of a machine what you put into it. So if you have a great bank of responses to a particular question, not knowing what question is going to be asked, you'd need a whole ton of memory for that. But if that syntax you're talking about makes it interesting and it breaks it down and allows, I would imagine, the computer system to understand what the answer is for the question that it was given.
That is absolutely correct, but there is more to that.
Okay.
And one is the understanding and the thinking. The other one is the interaction and learning. So you call it machine learning. The way this works is through the interaction with a counterpart, a user. Could be a user, could be another machine. So if I am Watson and I answer a question you post and the answer is wrong, you don't agree, you tell me. And basically, from this interaction, I'm learning. I go back to the data, I do more data search, and I learn from this experience to give you a better answer next time it happens. So that's kind of the foundation of machine learning.
So the growth curve really has a lot to do with education. And the more the user of this technology is educated on how it works and why it works, then that's going to open the door for even more development down the line.
Yeah, absolutely. Education it actually happens for the user and for the machine.
Okay.
And specifically for the machine is kind of interesting because if you look at a car, the day you walk out of a dealership with a car, that's the very best moment for the car. It will only get worse over time. If you look at Watson, well, the first day you start using it, that's by far the worst day ever. It will never be as stupid as the day one. But what Watson does, every single day, every single interaction, every single moment, keeps learning and expanding the knowledge and being more self-sufficient, resilient, and expert. And so the more you use it, the faster gets trained and learn how to support and provide insights and ideas.
Now, Watson is a kind of the IBM Watson system is a global name for this particular technology. Am I correct on that?
This is correct. Watson was one of the IBM founders.
Okay.
And so we decided to give a name. And actually, you see now in the marketplace a number of similar AI engines, all of them come with a name, Alexa and Cortana and so on. And it's an effort to make them a little bit more human. So Watson was our founder, and that was the decision to name this portfolio of APIs, programming interfaces and technology and processes that make this work.
Now, what or how can a business or an organization use some of this technology to their advantage? From a empathy standpoint or visual, what are some of the things? You showed me a graph earlier that I found extremely interesting. Perhaps you could enlighten us a little on some of the uses and how it can be integrated into, the workplace.
Okay, sure. So Watson, in essence, is an engine that takes data and makes sense out of data and allows a user make better decisions based off data. Could be genomic, could be weather, could be incidents and tickets in a service desk. The real power of Watson is it's built with standard APIs, advanced programming interfaces, which are building blocks off the shelf. You can pick and choose to access the data that you have or that you make available to the engine. So these APIs include things like natural language classifier, recognition, translation. We have sentiment analysis to understand if the interaction is going towards a contentious kind of conversation. We have a speech recognition, voice to text, text to voice, multiple languages. We have the ability to read images and videos in addition to voice. So it's all these tools to really get easier access to the data and work on the data to get decisions and support.
Now, does a company that perhaps brings this technology into their workplace, a larger or small organization, it doesn't really matter, will they be given the tools or the background knowledge needed to make this technology function on an ongoing basis? Or do they need someone perhaps like CareWorx to kind of guide them along the way? I'm assuming they would, because for a lot of folks, technology tends to run away with you. You know, you need to know what's going on before you can be comfortable with it.
Yeah, absolutely. So there is the ability to do it yourself. You just can select a number of APIs, deploy them, and train a cognitive engine to do the reasoning and the thinking. Mm-hmm. But the vast majority of the implementations we see is based on relying on a party like IBM or CareWorx to do the managed service, okay, do the work for you, so that you don't have to reinvent everything from the beginning. You get a jump start because we already have a lot of data, curated data, that has been validated, cleaned up, and fed into an AI system, so that it makes it much easier and faster to deploy that. So the managed service provided by IBM CareWorx is certainly a way to move much faster and focus on the understanding of the data and the use of the recommendation of the ideas coming out of an AI system.
I see. Now, what kind of impacts will AI have to the service desk in its basic forms?
That is, there is an underlying different question that I want to address before.
Okay.
Because one of the concerns in the market is AI going to replace humans? Okay. And as I said before, we really promote the message that is augmented intelligence. So it's really in support of the humans. And back to the service desk, AI, cognitive Watson, is not going to replace the service desk agents. It's going to give a better user experience to a user that 24/7 can interact with a Watson virtual agent that has a lot of knowledge. But the level 1, level 1.5, the expert in the help desk will mm-hmm. still be needed for those situations where a machine can just not deal with the complexity, the interaction, or the specific situation. And what we see from our implementation is that an agent has now more time to focus on the relationship with the user, on going deeper into resolving problems. And so it's really not replacing a human. It's allowing a human to do a much better job by removing some of the background noise, the easy things that could be dealt automatically.
Very interesting conversation. We have more to come on News Talk 580 CFRA. Our guest this hour, Marco LaVecchia, he's the Executive Vice President and General Manager at CareWorx, and Piero Chiodo, he's the Vice President, IBM Global Technology Services. We're talking about AI. We're talking about how it's going to work for you in the future. Certainly it's starting now on Experts on Call. I'm Dave Watts. We'll be right back. Experts on Call continues on News Talk 580 CFRA. Dave Watts with you this hour. And our guests in studio here, Marco LaVecchia, he's the Executive Vice President and General Manager at CareWorx, and Piero Chiodo, he's the Vice President of IBM Global Technology Services. Marco, it's great to see you again. It's been a while since we got together.
Thanks. Nice. Great to be here.
Nice to see you. And it's great to meet you, Piero. And what an interesting conversation. Great to have you on board, too.
So exciting to be here and talking about AI.
Absolutely. Now, if you're just joining us, our conversation this hour is about something that's going to be affecting all of us in some way or another in the next 2, 5, 10, 15, 20 years, definitely into the future. But it's starting now, and the earlier we can get on board in terms of understanding it, the better. And that topic, of course, artificial or assistant intelligence, and IBM is in the driver's seat with this on a major way. And I have to ask you, Piero, What are some of the challenges for organizations to stay on top of this rapidly changing technology?
Well, one is the ability to understand and manage the data, because the data and the decisions that an AI system is going to make is as good as the quality of the data.
Sure.
So it's curation, but also it's making sure that you have the right sources of data. Now, when you have this system in place, the two key challenges that we see are to create automation driven by a cognitive engine. So the AI solution starts acting for the user and not just assisting. So you can have an AI engine resetting a password or clearing up the cookies on your machine, and ideally doing that even before you have a problem. So that's really the full assistance. And so how to implement that by leveraging a variety of other components and technologies around the AI engine. Okay. And then the second area, which is to me very, very critical, is the adoption. And like everything, there are generations and professionals that are very quick learners. If you look at the millennial, they would never pick up the phone and talk. They would rather prefer texting, messaging, mm-hmm. or using other interaction engines. But a lot of our traditional workers are somewhat hesitant in switching to voice. And so how do you make the adoption of these new technologies in the service desk or any other area in your enterprise happen? And this is where we work very closely with our partners community, because they are much closer to the users, to the situation, to the companies. They are next to them and step by step walking them through this process of learning and adoption and deployment.
You know, and as you say, it's an assisting tool. Now you're right about the communication aspect of today's millennials. You know, are more comfortable texting and writing notes and so on and so forth than actually maybe even leaving a voice message, than actually speaking or engaging that way. But I think this is something that this technology can really benefit. That it can help them along the way, allowing them to integrate into conversation more with their clients. I mean, it's going to be a great tool to walk hand in hand with the real thing, with the cognitive aspect.
And with that being said, I think we're really there from a whole society standpoint. When you take a look at some of the new solutions that people are using, whether it's Apple Siri or Alexa, and not even realizing that they're using AI on a daily basis by asking questions, and instead of going to the internet and doing research, right, they can ask Alexa a question and you're going to get an answer. So I think as the common population of people that would not necessarily use AI are using it on a mainstream level, you're going to see more acceptance of it as technology evolves.
One of the things that I've heard people talk about anytime I've mentioned AI in a conversation with some friends or colleagues is the aspect and the importance of privacy and security. Those are two things that are really top of mind with folks these days. You think of all of the things that's been in the media over the past while on security issues with regard to technology. And I'm just wondering, how can these new AI systems ensure privacy and security?
Yeah, that's a good question. Certainly it's front and center of what we do. So first of all, the underlying infrastructure we selected for the operation of the AI engines is either a private cloud or a hybrid cloud model. Okay. So that's our preferred mechanism, so that you can start building some fencing around the areas that you work on. The second key element is we take a lot of the data, we do local encryption, and we can store it locally as opposed to the cloud to really protect an additional layer of privacy and control. And of course, our European colleagues with the GDPR initiative, mm-hmm. they are keeping us very busy in making sure that those privacy conversations are properly addressed. So that's really, we are taking a lot of time and attention. And the third element is, of course, the data in IBM's philosophy and IBM's partner philosophy is property of the client.
Right.
We don't gather the data, we don't resell the data, we don't use the data. We enable companies to access their own data and make business decisions based on that. So the privacy and the property of the data stays with the whoever has the ownership of the data.
I see. Marco, perhaps you can answer this one. How can organizations address concerns that their customers may have concerning shifts to AI?
Yeah, I'll always go to the premise of education is going to be key, making sure that we're working closely with our customers, explaining to them exactly the technology that's on hand, how it's going to benefit an organization, really the direct impact that it's going to make to the user on a daily basis. So anytime that you're introducing new solutions and technologies, whether it's AI or a new security feature, there's always concerns in terms of, you know, what it really means to the overall business. So we really kind of take the premise of, you know, working closely with the client and educating them exactly how it works and all the different intricacies of the solution that we're introducing.
So what kinds of or what types of customer service interactions represent the best opportunities for automated services?
Yeah, like you know, we had this conversation, Piero and I, last week when we were in Las Vegas doing some planning around this. Mm-hmm. The Watson platform is not for everybody, right? If we have a lot of senior care facilities that we look after. You know, I wouldn't say that it's a great idea to roll out Watson in a senior care facility, but we got some financial institutions, some new ones that, you know, you have millennials working there, right? That, you know, they love the support that we bring, but they also want some automation and some AI built into how they work, how they can basically go through a knowledge base, discover a problem, figure it out on their own, and get that personal satisfaction in terms of dealing with something.
Now, when the services get rolling, when AI services become more predominant in the marketplace, will there be parallel systems in place until such time as the technology can be perfected for whatever the need might be at that time? In other words, parallel services, a service that the average customer understands and knows, perhaps not knowing what AI can do or how it can benefit them. Will there be parallel systems in play?
Well, AI will never totally replace humans or current processes.
Okay.
Will augment, will improve, will accelerate, but will not totally displace. So this is why the personal touch, the local presence, the CareWorx people next to the client, teaching an AI system but gathering the data, refining and evolving and expanding is always going to be there. So these parallel systems are not going away. They're going to be more directly focused on the higher complexity, more value, but they're going to remain in place.
Marco, the Tech Talks series is an amazing opportunity for folks to learn about what's going on and staying on top of the industry. What are some of the big takeaways from Wednesday's Tech Talks, and certainly more Tech Talks that I suspect are planned down the road?
Yeah, like... definitely a lot of interest. So this is this is the third Tech Talks that we did. We started off with, the first two Tech Talks were around security. Mm-hmm. We had a lot of people come out and see us and just kind of learn more about CareWorx and what we're talking about from a business standpoint. The minute that we introduced the AI, and this was our third Tech Talks, our subscription rates to joining the event increased dramatically. So we had over 130 people attend this time around. And I just think that, like, when you take a look, especially in the city of Ottawa, with all the high-tech companies, we actually did some market research in the city, and there's over 200 companies in the city that have something to do with AI.
So, unbelievable.
So that just kind of gives you the interest in a nutshell, but also really bodes well for the city that we're at the forefront of technology in the world.
Well, you guys are in the driver's seat for sure. Tech Talk series. Any idea when the next one might be, or is it too early to tell?
Yeah, we're doing them on a quarterly basis right now. So our next one should be some nice weather during the summertime.
Perfect. Going to take a quick break again on Newstalk 580 CFRA. Our guest this hour, Marco LaVecchia, Executive Vice President and General Manager at CareWorx, and a special guest, Piero Chiodo. He's the Vice President, IBM Global Technology Services. Experts on Call is the program on Newstalk 580 CFRA. Experts on Call continues on News Talk 580 CFRA. I'm Dave Watts, and a good afternoon to you. Our guest is Marco LaVecchia, Executive Vice President and General Manager at CareWorx, and Piero Chiodo, Vice President, IBM Global Technology Services. And once again, Piero, welcome to Ottawa. Welcome to 580 CFRA. It's great to see you.
Super. Thank you.
And we've had an interesting conversation this hour, and there's still more to come. But I want to flip over to you, Marco, on this question. So why is CareWorx introducing AI to its customers?
Yeah, we just think it's an important solution and technology that we need to introduce to our customers. We've talked about the market changing, the industry changing, and the profile of the user changing as well. And this is really about us staying ahead of the curve and ensuring that we're introducing the right products and solutions to our customers. If we take a look in terms of how we deliver service desk to our customers, mm-hmm. Just making sure that the customer satisfaction scores are extremely high, making sure that they have access to information, that they can get the information that they want very, very quickly, and then always ensuring that we have that human element of supporting them in terms of what they need, because the computers are not going to fix everything. But we will get to a point where we can start automating things. And if we take a look at the most amount of calls that we deal with on a daily basis, password resets is really something that a lot of organizations struggle with. Passwords need to be so complex nowadays, people forget them. And then, you know, from a security standpoint, they don't store them in the right spot. So we get in this cycle where it's just, those are some of the triggers in terms of the highest call volumes that we deal with. And so if we can get to a point where we can automate those things, we know that our customers are going to be much more happier in terms of dealing with us.
So it's important for the customers to stay on top of the curve, the knowledge curve, as it is for your staff, for sure, because from your CareWorx standpoint, the technology is changing quickly, but that information has to be relayed back to your customers so they get it.
Yeah, absolutely. And, our customers are smart. Like a lot of them, sometimes they're coming to us requesting these new solutions and technologies. So we have some customers that probably have more technology in their homes than we do, that just really kind of is a testament to where the market is today, right? and what type of company we need to be. I'll say this: like, we're the 28th largest managed service provider in the world. And that is really ensuring that we bring the right solutions, technologies, and components to the table to making sure that our businesses are operating properly.
Marco, different needs, different customers. Everyone has a specific need. How does CareWorx determine specific IT requirements?
Yeah, we do that through, as I mentioned earlier on, through consulting with our customers. So when we work with our customers, we attach what's called a virtual chief information officer, a VCIO, to all of our accounts. And this person actually will sit down with the client, understand what their technology needs are, but also work on 3 and 5 year technology roadmaps. Because as you know, technology evolves. Some of the, whether it's a hardware component becomes obsolete over a period of time. There's new phishing scams or security scams that are out there that we need to deal with. And we may be using a component that was great 2 years ago, but as we move into 2018 and into 2019, we might need to change the platforms and the technologies that we're using. So we really want to make sure that we work closely with them to understand what their needs are and then how we can support them.
And it's, again, important to underscore the importance of privacy and security. Those are two areas that I would say most organizations are really interested in and are really crucial in their survival.
Absolutely. And and that's why ensuring that you're working with the right partner like IBM when you're dealing with technologies. We're an organization that deals with Tier 1 vendors. We're not looking at some of the new up-and-coming companies that really haven't proven themselves in the marketplace. So that is one thing that we really strive on as a business.
Piero, I have to say, IBM is certainly on a growth curve. How does the future look? Must be exciting for you folks.
Well, it's very, really exciting. And when you look at the AI, it's not new. We have been doing that for quite some time, but if you look just at 2020, 2 years out, some of our research shows that 80% of the first level relation or conversation with a help desk agent will be through a machine. 80% by 2020.
By 2020.
If you look at the investments on chatbot, actbot, all this automated answering, by 2020, more than 50% of the investment for chatbot will be bigger than mobile applications development.
I've heard chatbot, that word before. What is it, for those that don't know?
Chatbot is a kind of one of the building blocks of AI. It's a program conversation based on data and decisions. So you add machine learning, language recognition, and more, and then you have an artificial intelligence engine. And so the value of all this is that it's happening, it's here to stay, and the sooner you start investing and working in it, you will be harvesting the benefits way before 2020.
I can see the growth happening exponentially, too, because with it's like anything. With technology, I mean, it seems that things change on a day-to-day basis. Can you imagine what it's going to be like in 10 years from now? It's going to be amazing, some of the technology that's going to be out there.
Yeah, and you need to start early so that you really can shape your future and take the most advantage of being a leading innovator in this marketplace.
Now, if a client or a customer or an interested person wants to learn more about IBM Watson, for example, is there a spot on the IBM website that they can check out?
Definitely. We do have spots on websites. We have a lot of external presence for every industry. So it's certainly for IT, but again, healthcare, financial decisions, you can really apply AI to a variety of areas. And back to the service desk, we see a phenomenal customer satisfaction, positive reaction, responsiveness from our users. It's very exciting. So it's quickly giving some tangible, sizable, measurable benefits. And again, start early and explore a number of options, possibly with a partner like CareWorx.
Absolutely. And you know, Marco, I can see that you folks have your hands full as this technology continues to unfold, as it will. Today, tomorrow, next week, next month, in the coming years, wow, the future is amazing.
Yeah, no, we're really excited about it. I think it positions our company very well in the marketplace. I know we're very excited about it, and we know our customers are very excited about it. So we'll see what the future holds. But the way technology is changing and how it's evolving so quickly, I think it's a very exciting time.
Piero, Chiodo, thank you so much for dropping by and lending some great information to the show this afternoon.
Thank you for the great conversation and delighted to be here. I wish you well.
Thank you, sir. And Piero is the Vice President, IBM Global Technology Services. And Marco LaVecchia, always a pleasure, Marco, Executive Vice President and General Manager at CareWorx. Best of luck with your next talks coming up. The next, Tech Talks will be coming up quarterly, you were saying?
Yeah, so thank you very much for having me. Always a lot of fun and love the conversation.
Perfect. News is next on News Talk 580 CFRA.